Okay, welcome back. This is the last part of this production where we are delving into the latest accusations and insults of the ex-intelligence chiefs in this country, in the United States, against Donald Trump. And even going as far as telling Donald Trump he should be ashamed of himself, which is a very emotional term and it's not a very diplomatic term. At any rate, you were talking about Hillary Clinton being the perfect Manchurian candidate who felt entitled to be in the White House, who felt that's her manifest destiny, that should be awarded to her. And she didn't. She lost. And we have this other gentleman, we have this gentleman, you know, Donald Trump, who in and out of itself is disastrous in all these other areas. But in this particular area, I find myself in convergence with him. In all other areas, be it North Korea, be it the Middle East, be it his Iranophobic language against Iran, and then his blind support of Israel and Saudi Arabia, I am a complete divergence with this president. But the last thing I want to mention in this production is that, you know how the media is setting up Mr. Trump against everybody else, especially the deep state? There seems to be this war of words and all these arguments, all the tweeting that goes around. And they're trying to create some kind of a contrast, a compare and contrast that Mr. Trump is actually, in opposition to, the system in Washington, and how Mr. Trump says he's going to drain the swamp and all this language that, he uses, posing himself as an anti-establishment candidate. Now, here's somebody who's part of the 1%. Here's somebody whose father lent to him. He says, my father lent to me a small loan. But the small loan happens to be $1 million back in the 1950s. You add inflation to it, it would be around $14 million today. I don't think $14 million is a small loan. Okay? So he is as a silver spoon-fed, spoiled brat child at that time, and a bully president, unfortunately, today, I don't believe he's the populist. I believe he projects that image. I believe he's riding that wave of discontent and anger in this country to the point that some of these, poor people in this country, the electorate, actually think he's on their side. And this is what I want to mention in this last part of this production. Regardless of the whole debacle between Mr. Trump and everybody else, the intelligence services, the body of power, the deep state, whatever we call it, the international banking system, whatever you want to call it, in my academic opinion, this is nothing but a good cop, bad cop trick. The good cop in this case seems to be Mr. Trump standing up to the globalist, power gobblers versus being an economic nationalist and all this versus the actual globalist. I think the whole thing is a show. The whole thing is a sick joke on the American people, especially those who voted for Mr. Trump. And I don't believe any of these posturings. I really don't. I mean, Mr. Trump made a lot of promises, but when he came into power, I don't know if reality struck him or he was just a pawn of this globalist. And he tricked many people to getting into power. Who knows if he's going to be elected into a second term? Again, there's no way to forecast that. We have to sort of know the zeitgeist of this country in 2020. That's right, in 2020 elections. Who knows if the world's still going to be around? God forbid we obliterate ourselves. Hopefully that will not happen, but I believe it's just a good cop, bad cop trick. I think at the end of the day, Mr. Trump is very much a globalist, contrary to the desires of his and the projection and the wishful thinking of the people who voted for him to be an economic nationalist and otherwise and other areas of social nationalist, political nationalist. I think contrary to all of that, Mr. Trump is with the rest of them. And this whole thing is just a political posturing. They try to create some kind of a choice, as if you have a choice in this country between the establishment in Washington, people that Mr. Trump wants to drain out of the swamp, and somebody like him who, in my opinion, just rode the wave of the Tea Party. that started in the early 2000s, and it went all the way to the late 2000s, and then the left kind of tried to have their own version that we call the Wall Street Occupy movement, which was totally unorganized, and we saw the demise of that. So the desire on the far left and the far right, and not even, I shouldn't say far left or far right, the desire of people on both sides of the spectrum, the ones that are truly devoted, let's just call them, for the sake of the argument, far left and far right, they had much more in common, actually, than all the people, the so-called moderates in the middle. The moderates were basically nothing than sellouts, unfortunately, and you could hardly tell them apart whether they're Democrat or Republican. And so this libertarian desires, shall we say, that Mr. Trump wrote, he didn't know where to take the country with that, or he pretended he did, but I don't think he really did. I don't think he really did. He didn't. I think he's part of the same establishment, part of the same cabal, and that's what the American people have to wake up to. At any rate, thank you so much for your support and watching this video and having perseverance to follow these geopolitical and internal political topics. And please support us by subscribing to this YouTube channel in order to get the regular updates. Thank you so much. Let your hearts not be troubled in these desperate times, what appears to be desperate times. The good men and women of honor and integrity and principles are very active. Don't think we're sitting around and not doing anything. We are very active. And and we have to keep the faith. Keep the faith alive for better days and for an era where we would have peace and prosperity and tranquility and stability. Thanks again. Have a wonderful morning, afternoon, or night, whichever time zone you're at.